Hey, what up, fam? Kevin here. I hope you're doing well. We are continuously praying for you. We're praying for our state. We're praying for our country. We're praying for wisdom and discernment as they navigate the craziness and uncertainty that is this season. And I hope that that wisdom and discernment, with the backing of good data, gets us to a place where we can meet and be together. And so keep the faith, stay strong. We love you, and yeah, just hope you're doing well. I want to get right into it. We're continuing our series in the book of James, which I love still. And we're heading into chapter 2, and we're going to start in the middle of the chapter. Not that the other stuff isn't good, but we have 5 weeks to do this, so we're kind of bounce around a little bit. But we're going to be in James chapter 2, and as you read this passage together in your small group, or if you're watching it by yourself, I just want you to read it slowly, especially depending on the translation you're reading. I think sometimes writers like Paul and James, they can, when we translate things from the original Greek to English, these sentences can turn really confusing really fast if we don't really take the time and read them carefully. And so my challenge to you as you read this together is please take your time, read it line by line, verse by verse, word by word, and just take in what James is trying to say so that when we come back together, we can really dive into this well. And so now is the time for you to pause the video and go ahead and read James chapter 2, verses 14 through 26 by yourself or in your small group. We'll see you soon. And so this is a good word today, and this is a really encouraging and challenging passage for the reader, I think, because it really calls out our faith. It really calls out what kind of Christian am I in this world? And these are big questions that we have to ask ourselves if we're going to have a robust, ever-growing faith in Jesus that we call sanctification. If we're going to go through and become like Jesus in his likeness and character, then we have to have these hard conversations. We have to put our life up to the microscope that is Scripture and see where it all aligns. And James wastes no time, right? He hops right in, starting in verse 14. He says this, "What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him?" And I think as we read this, we should see this verse, and it should strike us. It struck the original readers of James to call out something like that, and it should strike us as well as we're trying to navigate this. And what I think James is really trying to say here is, can you be a follower of Jesus if your life looks exactly the same as it did before you came to faith? Right? In other words, can you be a follower of Jesus and act and be the same as those that don't? Like, wow. Ouch. Those are hard words to hear. And maybe you heard me read this or even hear the answers or the questions I just read, and your immediate reaction is to put your head down or not look straight, or you know, when you feel that guilt inside because there's something going on, whether it be a bigger thing or a smaller thing, the Holy Spirit kind of convicts us in ways when we read Scripture like this. And that's okay. I want us to dive into that. I want us to enter in to that awkwardness and that guilt and that shame and say, what is God teaching me through it? Because I think when we read this passage, when we read this verse, the obvious answer is no, right? We should not be the same as people that don't know Jesus if we know Jesus, right? Our life should look different than those around us. But unfortunately, we get into times and seasons where our life does not look different, right? Think of how many times in your life or people around you, have you seen people, hey, I come to this place, whether it be a camp or something else, where they're like, okay, I'm rededicating my life to Jesus. I'm doing it. And then we come home, and slowly but surely over time, we start to fall back into our old habits. We fall back into our old ways. And all of a sudden, our life doesn't look any different than the people around us before we left for camp or heard the message or whatever the case may be. I can't think of the countless times in my life where I've looked at myself in the mirror or been in prayer and said, Jesus, this is, I'm done. This is it. I can't live this way anymore. I'm done. And only to see myself within minutes, within hours, within days, within weeks, finding myself back in the same place I was before I made the declaration. And so our lives are supposed to look different, right? A robust faith in Jesus looks different from what the world has to offer. And so what I want to dive into today is, what are the marks of that? Right? Well, how does a robust faith show itself in our life? Because obviously James here is saying that our life needs to look different. And so how does it look different? How do we know that it looks different? And what does that look like? And so those are the things we're going to tackle today. We're going to get back into starting in verse 15 through 17. And you guys read it. What James does here is he gives an example of the question he asked, right? He gives the example. He says, hey, can you be a follower of Jesus and have the same lifestyle you did before? And the reader's working through this and you're like, no. He's like, okay, well, let me give you an example of what I'm talking about just to make sure that we're clear here. And he says, here's the thing. It'd be like seeing a homeless person on the street and he's obviously cold and hungry just by the way he looks. There's no question that's the thing that this person needs. And for someone to walk up to that person and be perfectly in the place to help them and look at them and say, hey, bud, good luck. Hey, stay warm out there. It's a cold one. Make sure you get some food. You look really hungry, and then leave on their way. What good is that? Hey, good luck. I'll see you later. It's just empty words with no substance, right? And this is the foundation that James is laying for the rest of the passage today, that our faith in Jesus shows itself in mighty ways. And if we just have faith or if we just have works, those both end in destruction because they're worthless. And just like going up to a homeless person that's hungry and cold and saying, hey, good luck, be warm and eat, I'll talk to you later, does nothing. So do we, in a sense, when we are saying, okay, well, I only have faith or I only do good things. There's something wrong there. And that's what James is trying to get in here. And so he moves on starting in verses 18 and 19. And I want to warn you, we have some James Sass alert coming up. And I love it, right? And so James gets into it. He gives a rhetorical retort to the scenario he just gave. He's walking through an argument with us, guys. He's walking through this thing of faith without works is dead. And he's showing us why that's the case by using examples that we would relate to. And so he gives a retort to what he just said. And the retort is, hey, well, what about me? Hey, you show me a faith without works and be perfectly fine. I'll show you works without faith being perfectly fine. That they are separate and they can be separate. Not that they need to be, but they can be. Right? That's the rhetorical retort he's saying here. It's like, hey, what about me? I think that they can be separate and be perfectly fine. Well, here's where the sass comes in. He says, hey, you believe that God is one. You believe in God, right? And who he is. Well, that's good for you. That's awesome. Because even the demons who are working adamantly against God in the mission believe the same thing. Yet it does nothing to change their life, right? That knowledge of who God is has not changed the demon's mind of saying, oh, well, now I'm fine. I follow that. It's worthless. Like, faith and understanding by itself is just knowledge. It's empty. It's worth nothing. It's just knowledge. And if you claim to follow Jesus, but it doesn't lead you to act on it, it doesn't lead you to act and do something and to become more like him, then it's time to reevaluate our relationship. Right? I want to stop right there because this doesn't mean that you're not a follower of Jesus, right? We go through seasons of life where life happens or things where we fall away a little bit and we look at things and we say, hey, you know what? I'm not seeing anything from my life, right? I go to church, I sing the songs, I do the things, but I'm not led to do anything. I'm, I'm, I feel kind of empty inside. Like, that's okay. We go through seasons like that. We go through seasons like that. And just because you might not see works or deeds played out in your life does not mean that all of a sudden, hey, one, God doesn't love me, or two, I was never a believer in the first place. This is just an opportunity where James is saying, hey, if you find yourself in this situation, well, let's take a back, let's take a microscope into my relationship, and let's go through all this and see what's going on here. Because maybe it just means that, hey, I'm running on empty. And maybe I have an understanding of who God is right now in this season of life, and I have a faith in him, but I'm not being poured into personally, or I'm not taking my relationship of God to the next level. I'm not reading or praying well, and really being filled that way. And so I have nothing to give people. And so there are no works, because there are no deeds, because I'm running on empty. Because here's the thing. Faith by itself is just knowledge. It gets us nowhere, because if we just have faith, we just have an understanding of who God is, but then we don't have an understanding of what God did on this earth through Jesus, right? We don't know, we don't wrap our heads around the works that God did to love people, to love the marginalized, to love God, and to love others. We're no better than the Pharisees in the New Testament who followed the law to the letter, but that was it. That all they had was head knowledge. They had no practical nature of it. You just needed to follow these rules and God would love you. And as we know, because of Jesus, that is not how Christianity works. And the second part, and likewise, deeds by itself is just mindless work that has no meaning. Because we haven't wrapped around the fact that the reason, the meaning behind our work, which goes all the way back to the cross, right? And Jesus's grace and mercy and his love that he showed on us. And if God is going to love us at our worst, then I can love people at their worst. And so if we just do works without the faith aspect, then we're just doing nice things for no reason. We're not doing it with the sense of, hey, I want God to be glorified through this. Because here's the deal, and here's the main idea. It'll be up on your video here. A robust faith in Jesus overflows into deeds that bring glory to him. Right? A robust faith in Jesus, a faith in Jesus where we are going all in, right? Where we're praying, we're reading, we're talking to other people, we're being filled by the Holy Spirit. A robust faith, that's how I'm defining that. A robust faith in Jesus, we're growing in his likeness and character, has to lead to something. And that thing overflows into deeds that bring glory to God. And what does that look like practically? Well, I want to go back into scripture and I want to read just this passage in Matthew, because I think it's really important. And you've heard it before because we've read it, but I'm going to read it again. It says this in Matthew 22, starting in verse 37. And he said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." And for you visual learners, because I'm a visual learner, I want to take this to the next step. So let me just drag this in real fast. Here we go. All right, this is the idea that James is getting at, okay? That a robust faith in Jesus, right? And what we've just defined, a robust faith in Jesus overflows into deeds that bring glory to him. And what does that look like? It means our robust faith, when we're praying, when we're going deep into the word, right? When we are taking our faith seriously, it gets us to the top. But as we keep going, it overflows into others and the deeds that we do, right? And we don't do these deeds because we think that God isn't going to love us if we don't do them. We do them because God first loved us, and God first cared for us and gave us grace and gave us mercy. And so why not? Why should we not extend that to other people in the name of Jesus, not on our own power, but because of him who works in us? And what do these deeds look like? That's what I want to end with today, because we might look at it like, what does that mean? Like, should I be going around and just feeding the homeless and doing all those things? Yes. The answer is yes. Jesus cared and loved the marginalized, the people that were outcasted, right? And so practically, one of the main things that we look at is, is the widows, the orphans, the homeless, the needy. These are people that God calls us specifically to love and to care for, right? To love the marginalized. But more than that, but just as important as that is the way that we live our life, right? Deeds come out on the way that we live our lives on the field, in the classroom, on the stage, at work. The way that we live our life shows who we place our faith in and what we place our faith in. And so we should live a life so robust that when people look at us, they ask the question either to us directly or then themselves, what's so different about this person? It's because your cup is so overflowed that your robust faith, your faith in Jesus is growing so much and you're becoming more like him that you can't help but to start acting like him. And so ask yourself today, ask yourself right now, is my faith overflowing into my actions? Is my faith overflowing into am I seeing me do things for Jesus? Could be big things, could be small things. And the second thing is how are you pursuing a robust faith? And if you're not, if you don't feel like you're pursuing a robust faith, what is the next right step you can take to pursue that robust faith and grow in Jesus' likeness and character? And so your life can overflow into others on a daily basis, and we can love people the way that Jesus did. So Anchor fam, I love you so much. I miss you. Can't wait to see you in small groups. I hope, like I said, you're doing well, and I will talk to you very, very soon. Peace.